You got that right, Kevin.
Well, we're waiting for a few more to trickle in. We had a little bit of technical difficulties to start off, but you know, that's what we all get this year. But well, first, I guess maybe I'll start with a welcome. Well, good evening and welcome to tonight's Q&A discussion with world-renowned soil health expert, Gabe Brown. The more people from all sectors that are educated and advocating for carbon and soil-focused farming, the better off we all are. Agriculture has a huge role in preserving our many resources. And when we know it comes to soil-friendly farming, we know that managed grazing is the gold standard. And when it comes to grazing organizations that support managed grazing, GrassWorks is also the gold standard. GrassWorks is a grassroots membership organization that's been around since there was early interest in this crazy idea of putting livestock back out in the pasture. They've been very supportive in education outreach ever since, and I encourage all of you to join as members, encourage others to do so. It's really the membership and the people and the farmers and our allies that you know, make this all possible. And we get so much from each of you and have a lot to offer through the resources. The link for registration, I believe I will post at some point. And while you're on the website, there's also resources listed there. And thank you to, in addition to GrassWorks, our other amazing sponsors for tonight's event. We have the Fagale Conservation Foundation, Prairie Creek Seed, Cashton Farm Supply, and Ag Country Farm Credit Service. Normally this GrassWorks big event of the year is our annual conference. Unfortunately, we're not gonna be able to get together live this year, and so we're gonna be offering kind of a range of these virtual events and a collaboration conference, which we'll have more information about later. But when it comes to our convention, we've got Heather Flashinsky, who's I was thinking as the glomalin and the mycorrhizal fungi of the organization and the conference, where she holds it all together, and she's the one that communicates with our amazing sponsors, as well as our presenters and our members, as well as our sometimes vocal board members, to make sure that what we're offering kind of targets what everyone is needing. Heather is going to go through some of the Zoom technical support issues, kind of the Zoom rules, and how the night is going to proceed. So I'm going to hand it over to Heather real quick, and then we'll come back.
All right. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, everyone, for being here. As you probably noticed, we had a few technical difficulties already, so we're all learning as we go with this. But I have a few question and answer guidelines that I'd love for you guys to pay attention to when you're on this, because there's a lot of you on right now and we all want to be able to hear Gabe. So be aware that when you do use the chat box, if you're comfortable with that, that everybody can see your comments. So if you wouldn't say it to someone in person, don't say it in the chat box. Just to be nice. And if you have any questions, issues, message me. It's admin Heather privately. And please take care of yourself. If you need to get up and walk around, this is gonna be a long night because Gabe says he's gone until there's no more questions left. So thank you, Gabe, for that. And please have patience and empathy, because we are trying to figure out all these systems with Zoom. So hopefully it all goes smoothly from here on out. To ask a question of Gabe, use the chat box or call or text me. My phone number is 715-379-3742. We're gonna ask that you all stay muted at all times, because the background noise will prevent everybody else from hearing Gabe. So please stay muted. And don't be scared if I mute you myself. I have that capability, so I might just do that. There is no right or wrong answer. We are all here to amplify Gabe's experiences. He's had a lot, and we look forward to hearing from him. This is being recorded and put on Facebook Live, so feel free to change your name or stop your video so that you can maintain your privacy. Here's a few guidelines for Zoom or tutorial on how to do things. If you need to mute yourself, there's a microphone, little decal on the bottom if you're on a computer and anytime you move your screen. Otherwise, so that click on that. If you're on a phone, hit *6 to mute yourself or unmute yourself, but I hope you all stay muted. And then to stop your video, there's a little video decal towards the bottom as well. Click on that to make sure that's stopped if you don't want people to be able to see you. And then the biggest one to know about is the chat box, which is the little cartoon bubble icon. Click on that and then type in your questions. Rachel and I will be able to see them and we'll make sure that Gabe gets them or is able to answer them. And if you want to private message us as well, if you don't feel comfortable sending it to everybody, you can click on Admin Heather and send me a message directly or moderator Rachel. If you want to see Gabe, after I stop sharing my screen, their gallery view will bring up either everybody or you can go to just the speaker. So just keep toggling on that gallery view to make sure you get to the point where you can see Gabe. And then if you want to change your name or your picture or whatever, you can go to the little blue dots above, hover above your picture and change your name to make sure it's what you want to be called for this. So for any tech support, call me at 715-379-3742. I will try my hardest to answer your questions. And again, I keep saying that because there are some people who are calling in. All right, back to you, Rachel.
All right, thank you for that, Heather. I feel like we all could use the reminders and tips. So while we're all here tonight, I hope all of you have had the chance to see the Kiss the Ground documentary at least once or maybe a few times. We really feel like this film has done a really great job in elevating this conversation and opening the audiences to having these conversations about regenerative agriculture. It focuses on how we can fight climate change through soil. When you think of soil icons, Gabe Brown comes to the top of the list. I think I was thinking of Family Feud top five answers, and I think you would be in there. This notoriety comes from all your extensive experience with a wide variety of crops as well as livestock. I'm going to thank you again for joining us tonight. And then maybe if you'd like to start with kind of introducing your involvement with the movie and kind of how you feel like it's brought this conversation into the light.
Sure. Thank you, Rachel, Heather. Pleasure to be with all of you. Thank you to the sponsors of tonight's meeting. Certainly appreciate their support. Actually, this film, Kiss the Ground, started about 7 years ago. And I became involved a little over 5 years ago when Josh Tickell had reached out to Ray Archuleta and had met with Ray and did a little filming. That's the opening of the movie there. They filmed that in Kansas. And the movie started out originally to be about soil, but about organic and the importance of the organic industry in regenerating soils. Well, that's how Josh got to know Ray. And then once he met with Ray, Ray said, well, it's way beyond that. You know, organic is good, don't get me wrong, but it's beyond that. It's about the whole soil health, plant health, animal health, human health connection. And Ray recommended to Josh that he come and meet me on my ranch. And so Josh and a film crew flew up here. It was 5 years ago, was the first time. And they spent almost 5 days up here filming. And I think when he left here, he had a much greater appreciation for the importance of livestock in healing our ecosystems. And so it changed the focus of the movie. And Josh went on, and he will tell you, Josh Tickell, the producer, that he learned himself quite a bit. Well, as with any movie, you know, you have funders, and the funders were trying to steer it one way, and Josh was trying to encompass as much as he could. Interestingly enough, they over the next couple of years, they put the film together and they ran it by test audiences. And one of the most liked sequences in the movie was when we were cracking those pastured eggs open, and they actually flew a film crew out from California out to my ranch to film that again. And we actually spent the greater part of a day cracking eggs open and filming to get the pictures they wanted. And that was 3 years ago that they did that. And it took them an initial 3 years to wrap it up. So it was originally set to open in over 1,000 different theaters. And then they were going to have the main debut at the Tribeca Film Festival. But COVID canceled all that. So it was kind of at a halt then until a donor stepped forward and paid for the sponsorship on Netflix. And so what the film has done, it absolutely amazes me. Just here on Tuesday, I was actually on a Zoom meeting with Prince Charles because he had seen the movie and liked what he saw. And then they invited me to take part in a roundtable discussion they were having. So it's a worldwide reaching event and medium. And I will say this, I thought I was getting a lot of emails before, but it's at least doubled, if not tripled, the amount of interest, whether it be emails or phone calls that I've gotten since it has debuted. So it's bringing a lot of awareness. Do we agree with everything in the movie? No, but let's all come together for the 80% of things we agree on and move forward from there. So I think it's a very good start. Just to let you know that I was on a phone call with Josh Tickell yesterday, and he is working on the sequel to this. He's going to start that. And so there's conversations being had for that. And we've talked about how we want that next one movie to go to the next level, to delve even deeper into the soil health, plant health, animal health, human health connection.
All right, great. I guess maybe all your emails segues into this next question. I've heard you sleep like 4 hours a night. Do you find a work-life balance, and do you have an active role in the processing facility you are a part owner in? What does an average day look like?
Okay, what is average to Gabe Brown? Yeah, my life's changed quite a bit in the past 5 years since the movie was first filmed. My wife and I have transitioned the ranch over to our son. I literally spend nearly all of my time in education as to regenerative. Last year I was on the road 282 days, 242 flights, so I got a few frequent flyer miles. But it's a good thing. No, I do not sleep much when I'm on the road. If I get an hour and a half a night, that's about it. And when I'm home, I sleep a little more, maybe up to 4 hours or so. I'm a person who can get by without sleep. Everyone tells me that's bad for my health. I tell them, what do I care? I've stayed awake more hours than a 90-year-old person. So it all comes out in the wash. What was the second part of that question?
Regards to the processing.
Oh, processing facility, right. Yes, the processing facility is a co-op, and there's approximately 75 members. Because of my involvement with education, my time away, I did not serve on the board there. My son served on the board since 2013 when we started working on that. He was on the board up until this past year. We do use that facility for some of our animals, but not all of them. It still is open and hanging in there, so that's a good thing. Business is pretty good right now due to COVID, but yeah.
And I guess Then one question was, the movie talked about the role of USDA policies in pushing agriculture down the destructive conventional commodity path. What do you feel is the appropriate role of NRCI and USDA in helping farmers become regenerative?
Yeah, I will say this much, that not only the movie, but more and more government is becoming aware of regenerative ag. I have had conversations with both Biden's policy team and Trump's team as to regenerative ag, trying to educate them. Unfortunately, it seems politicians want to regulate. The question I often get asked from them is, what laws can we enact? What policy can we make that forces farmers to do this? And of course, I fight back pretty hard on that, and that, you know, if you want to alienate farmers and ranchers, just go ahead and dictate policy and make laws, and that'll do it. And unfortunately, they seem to have a hard time understanding that it's education that's needed. And I think that's the biggest role for NRCS, you know. And in the movie, I kind of bashed all government help. And I really didn't mean to do that. I think there's a place for government to, in the education process, but let's face it, the system we're under is just flawed. I was just doing an interview for a large publication today, and I was explaining current farm program policy and revenue insurance, and it just doesn't make sense. Look at, you know, if it was so good, how come corn isn't, you know, we're only about 30 cents above what the price was 40 years ago. That's no decent government policy. And so government's role should be one of education primarily.
So while you continue to get pushback from government and policy, do you feel like the pushback from conventional farmers is getting less, or is it the same argument, or who's more bullheaded?
Yeah, and realize there'll always be some pushback from conventional ag, because we're going against their grain, against the norm, against what they see has provided them a lifestyle and a living. But it is much, much less than it was 3 to 5 years ago. You know, I think many of them are beginning to, they're going to do what they're going to do. You know, and my job as an educator is not to force this on anyone. My job is simply to inform and educate. You know, when the student is ready, the teacher will appear. Unfortunately, sometimes the students will never be ready. You know, unfortunately, on some farms, the only way to change is through death, you know, and that's sad to say, but it's true. And so I can only concern myself with working with those who want to learn.
I guess for those that are kind of trying to get those to jump over the cliff, I guess, what are effective approaches to engaging producers? Is there anything that you've used that's really kind of worked better than others?
Yep, money, profit. You know, this whole talk of regenerative ag and healing the ecosystems and, you know, putting more carbon in the soil and mitigating climate change, that's all well and good. But how's that going to happen if we don't have people out on the land? And without profitability, we're not going to have people out on the land. And profitability should not have to come through government subsidies. It should come from farmers and ranchers being able to grow and raise healthy, nutrient-dense foods, and then be compensated for them adequately and fairly. That's where it should come about. So when I go visit with producers, we talk economics first and show them that this path of regenerative ag is much more profitable than conventional ag.
So if you were starting a new farm, where would you begin? You know, with this economics in mind, or kind of with regeneration in mind?
Yep.
What would be the best bang for the buck for someone starting off?
Yeah, the first thing is they have to educate themselves. You know, I did a webinar for a group in Ireland yesterday morning, and I was showing them some of the work we've done showing total nutrient extraction, and we measured it on 45 farms here in the upper Midwest. There's plenty of nutrients on all 45 farms. We were not deficient in any nutrient in any of the 45 farms. What we were deficient in, though, was biology. See, and you're not going to learn that from your agronomist. You're not going to learn that from extension. You're not going to learn that from your equipment salesman, your seed salesman. No, you have to educate yourself as to how ecosystems function. Then that's the first step. Second step then is you have to understand your context. Where is your farm or ranch located? What's your context? What's your historical ecological context? What's best suited to that environment? And I use this as an example. For 26 years, I was in the purebred business calving in January and February in North Dakota. That's ridiculous. That's out of my ecological context. You know, imagine those poor calves being born then. That's out of context. Last year, I was in Manning, Alberta, which is way north Alberta. You fly into Edmonton and then drive for a day and you're at Manning, Alberta, and they were trying to grow soybeans up there. That's out of its ecological context. We need to work within our framework. And so often farmers and ranchers, you know, they're trying to impose their will on nature. They need to work within the context of where they're at and work with nature in order to be profitable.
So I guess still kind of with that seeding, you know, and encouraging diversity. Diversity is a, you know, one of the key principles of soil health. How would you encourage someone to bring more diversity onto their farm? And I guess with regard to that biology, the impact of livestock and the emphasis of having livestock in the system.
Yeah, well, if you go look at it, you know, I don't know if we can really find a true native ecosystem anymore, but go look at native ecosystems, tremendous diversity. You know, you'll find 100 plus more different species, grasses, forbs, legumes. You have many different animals, you know, thousands of different species of insects. That's diversity. Now, do we need to mimic that in its entirety? It's about impossible for us to do on any farm or ranch. But the fact of the matter is, the more diversity you have of plants, the more diversity you have below ground of biology, the more you're going to be able to cycle nutrients, have a healthy functioning water and mineral cycle, the healthier the animals and plants will be. What species of animals you have and raise on your farm or ranch, that depends on your context and what you want to do. I'm certainly not here advocating that everybody has as much livestock diversity as we do on Brown's Ranch. That may or may not be in your context. You have to decide that for yourself.
We've got a comment that there's not enough emphasis in the movie on the necessity of incorporating ruminants into regenerative agriculture solutions. Too many examples presented did not include animals. Why?
Mm-hmm. Why? That's simple. Because the movie started out more or less almost to the point of anti-animals on the landscape. We were extremely pleased with how much they did get in. But as I said, watch for Kiss the Ground 2, and we'll see what happens there.
Big old cow pie. can you describe a few instances when you learned what to do with cover crops? And I know one of your favorites is you aim to fail each year.
Yep.
Can you give a couple
So you were breaking up a little bit there, Rachel. Are you asking me what hasn't worked?
Yeah, what not to do.
Yeah, and there's many things. Realize, though, I always hesitate to tell people what didn't work on my place, because just because it did not work on my ranch here in North Dakota doesn't mean it won't work on theirs, wherever that may be. So you have to be willing to experiment for yourself. There are a few things that are fairly constant that we have seen have not worked well no matter where we try them. And one of those, for instance, is to have a fall seeded biennial such as cereal rye, and maybe some other species with it, triticale, winter wheat, hairy vetch, etc., and then graze that cover crop in the spring, and then try and direct seed a warm season mix into that. If you have not terminated that cereal rye, chances are pretty high that you will not have a very successful stand of those warm seasons. I'm not saying it can't be done, but we've seen it fail many more times than we've seen it successful. You have to terminate that fall seeded biennial, and that means either typically through tillage or herbicide.
Another question in the chat was, it seems the biggest barrier to having more diversity of crop and livestock products is the lack of accessible markets. Does every farmer need to be a direct marketer? How can we promote the development of markets for diverse products, pulse crops, alternative grains, small ruminants, etc.?
Great question. And we just had a direct marketing school at Seven Sons Farm in Indiana. And our emphasis there was on how do you add more value. It does not mean you have to direct market yourself. You know, you can sell into a larger value-added market. Where can you add value? But I tell you, I really believe that this is where most farmers and ranchers fall short. They're very, very good at producing things, raising things, growing things, but they prefer to let somebody else do the marketing. The greatest return on your investment will always be marketing. And the more time you can spend doing that, the better off you are. I often tell the story of a good friend of mine, Darren Williams in Kansas. He started growing non-GMO corn, and he said he literally made over 100 phone calls before he found a company that would offer him the price he wanted for his non-GMO corn. But he said that netted him an extra $200,000 plus. Now he said, do you think those 100 plus phone calls were worth my time? Absolutely. We did a webinar on marketing, Dr. Alan Williams and myself. The next evening, I had a call from a young producer in Missouri who had spent the whole day, after listening to us, he spent the whole day making calls to try and sell his barley into a value-added market. By the end of the day, he had two buyers for his barley at a significant premium. He said, that was the best day I ever spent. You know, you have to be willing to do the work. On our ranch, even though there's quite a few things to do on our ranch, my son will tell you more than 50% of his time is spent on marketing, but that's what makes it so profitable. So you do not have to direct market. You can find these other entities that will do the marketing for you, but at least add value somehow. You know, if you're producing a premium product, you deserve a premium price, but you got to do the homework. They're not going to come and find you.
Right. Thank you. Does anyone else have any questions while we're kind of talking about markets? Otherwise, we are going to transition and kind of pasture and soil management questions. We have had a speaker from the holistic management perspective at our conference for decades. What has been your experience been implementing these concepts and working with other holistic management practitioners?
Well, and I give holistic management credit for helping me dig out of the big hole my wife and I were in after those 4 years of hail and drought. Is I look at things in a different light now. You have every, as Dr. Ellen Williams says, everything you do has compounding cascading effects. They're either positive or negative, never neutral. So realize before you go out and spray that herbicide, before you go out, do that tillage pass, you need to think through what are the ramifications of it. Now, I'm not saying don't ever do those things, but you have to put the thought in. You know, so often, for example, farmers see a pest. Oh, we're going to go spray and kill that pest. But for every insect species that's a pest, there's up to 1,700 species that are beneficial. If I spray to kill that one pest, I'm also going to kill all the beneficials. We have to think of the whole ecosystem. And that's probably been the greatest thing that holistic management has brought to light for me, is we have to think of our farm or our ranch as a whole ecosystem. And every single thing we do out there is going to affect multiple things. We need to be aware of that.
Yeah, and not within just our own farm, across the landscape and with our communities and economies. Okay, I think we're going to kind of get into some pasture management questions. When is the best time to no-till in pastures and hay fields? We had another question about someone that didn't have kind of a no-till drill with kind of a seeding issues. How do you seed without a no-till drill?
Yeah, and you know, that really depends a lot on context, where you're at, moisture situation, what's the historical ecological context. I want to say one thing up front. One of the questions I often get asked is, well, how do I terminate my perennial pastures so I can plant annual cover crops? And my answer to them is always, why would you want to do that? The best cover crop out there is a very diverse perennial stand of grasses, forbs, and a small amount of legumes. You know, we need to realize that that's just succession. Nature starts out with annuals and moves to perennials. You're better off managing your pastures in a way that enhance the latent seed bank that's there and stimulate those seeds to germinate, and that's the best way to get diversity. I really want to say one other thing that we're running into over and over again, no matter where in the world we're consulting, and that is, by and large, the vast majority of producers put way too much legumes in the mixes. Natural ecosystems are very low nitrogen systems. And we've been sold this bill of goods somewhere along the way that we think we need all these legumes and that livestock need these high protein mixes. Yes, dairy cattle do need obviously higher protein compared to beef cattle, etc., but not near as high a protein as what one might think. And that's actually having negative ramifications on both soil health and on animal health. And we have to take a look and realize that nature is self-organizing, self-regulating, self-healing. Legumes will show up in nature because they're trying to jumpstart biomass growth in an ecosystem. But over time, under proper management, legumes will become much, much less lower component of the pasture mix. And if you're to ask me what is an ideal mix, well, again, I don't want to give too much numbers because it's going to depend on your context and if you're a dairy, et cetera. But rarely would I ever recommend over 15% legumes in a mix. It's just way too negative to soil health and animal health if you get much higher than that.
Can you talk a minute about kind of diversifying and selecting different management tools to select for some of those forbs and some how to manage to get more diversity within your pasture?
Yeah, and excellent question. The number one we see over and over again, no matter where we go, is too short of rest periods. You know, Dr. Williams and I have had many discussions about this, and there's no right or wrong because it has to fit your context. Obviously, you know, Wisconsin has a wetter environment than where I am in North Dakota. You're going to have shorter recovery periods than I am. I have found that on my ranch here in North Dakota, I need a minimum of 12 months, usually closer to 15 months, in order to get full recovery of the plants. Much shorter than that, now is losing species diversity. Now, producers we work with in the upper Midwest, Wisconsin area, and that typically we need at least 90 to 120 days. Now, there are times of the year you might be a little shorter than that, but you tend to need longer recovery time. And the way to think about that is, okay, if you run livestock through a paddock with good densities, lay down some good armor on the soil surface, you get nutrient cycling going, well, you're going to have a little seedling germinate there. Well, now, if you come back in 30 or 40 days, you know, that seedling is only 2 or 3 inches tall. And then what's that animal going to select? Well, they'll select that right away, and that plant will never establish, okay? The only way you're going to get them to establish is with longer rest periods. And I have a good friend in eastern Montana. He's on nearly a 2-year recovery period. There's areas in the southwest, much drier environment, even longer than that. But typically where you're at, Wisconsin, if most of you are from Wisconsin who are listening in, I'd say you'd want to be in that 90 to 120 days consistently in order to get some of that diversity established in those paddocks.
Along with rest, what would you recommend for restoring old pastures or kind of to give a jump on?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, another excellent question. So depends on what was in those pastures, what was the makeup of them, what species are there. But one of the things we've found that does work to help jumpstart them is usually you're seeing those weakened plants where you have a lot of ground between the plants. You know, they're not very productive. And so what we found is to go into those paddocks and actually use bale grazing as an advantage to add carbon to them. And I would actually recommend bale grazing with bales that have mature seed in them of species you want to establish in those paddocks. So on our ranch, we like putting on quote unquote native prairie. And then we will feed that in certain paddocks in order to get some of those seeds established. That once you do that, bale graze on those areas, you need longer recovery periods. In fact, if you're able to, it would not hurt at all to let those go for a full year and just not graze them and let those seedlings establish and get the root systems developed where they can be productive.
One of the questions was, when you started bale grazing, how quickly did you notice a change in that field? What changes did you observe first?
Yeah, the change was the very first year. And we actually did clippings where we bale grazed on a paddock, compared that to a paddock right next to it, no bale grazing. We tripled above ground forage biomass the very first year. You know, we significantly increased pounds of nutrients produced, you know, per acre in those paddocks. It was a night and day difference. Now, very quickly thereafter, you will notice that you will get some more diversity. Now, depending on what you're bale grazing in, realize there's species out there. You take, obviously, fescue, smooth bromegrass, Kentucky bluegrass. It's difficult to get some diversity established in some of those grass species. But we also noticed a big difference in soil aggregation because we're adding a tremendous amount of carbon, and that carbon then will feed biology, and that biology then will drive increased soil aggregation. So we noticed better aggregation, which meant better water infiltration rates. And it's pretty significant when you do it.
Would that be similar advice? One of the questions was, how long does it take to turn soil around from commercial ag? We have been working a farm for 4 years. We have seen tremendous yield boosts, but no appearance of soil life, especially dung beetles. We're talking about boosting pastures, but what do you do to encourage soil biology.
Yeah, and realized dung beetles back in 2009, 2008, we quit using all insecticides on our livestock. It took 2 years for our first dung beetle species to show up. And now we've documented 17 different species. It takes some time, you know, but they will find you, you know, build it and they will come. There's a lot of questions I would ask that producer before I could answer that is, okay, how much diversity is in the system? How large of a system is it? Does he have home and habitat for those predators and pollinators? One of the things we're seeing on our clients' farms and ranches is, you know, we strongly encourage perennial pollinator and predator habitat. Everybody has an odd-shaped field where it's hard to get in this little corner, or maybe it's down along a creek or something. Why not make that predator pollinator habitat, seed that back with a very diverse mix, high in grasses and forbs, as habitat? So you can't expect these species to show up if you're not providing a year-round home for them. And so I would need to know a lot of more about that person's context before I could answer more fully.
And then earlier with bale grazing, you were talking about water infiltration. Another one of the questions or comments was that regenerative agriculture focuses so much on conserving water, but what about heavier wet soils? Do you have any suggestions for management?
Absolutely. And we work with producers in extremely dry environments like Alejandro Carrillo down in the Chihuahuan Desert of Mexico. And he's in 6 to 8 inch rainfall environment. We're working on tropical operations, you know, with 200 plus inches of moisture a year. And the principles are the same. You have to build soil aggregates. Think of it as marbles in a jar. You know, the more aggregates you get, the more marbles in a jar, the more water you're going to be able to infiltrate. So if you're in a dry environment, you want water to infiltrate so that you can store it there via organic matter. If you're in a wet environment, you need your soil to be marbles in a jar so it will infiltrate and then disperse throughout the whole soil profile. And I tell people that we've done some very intensive soil testing on our ranch. And when I started, our A horizon topsoil was literally 4 to 5 inches. Well, now we have aggregated soil in some places deeper than 48 inches. Okay, so think of that. We've documented scientifically using a dual head infiltrometer, we can infiltrate over 30 inches of rainfall per hour. Think about that. I've never seen it rain that much, you know? Yeah, even Monty Botten's where he's at, he doesn't get that much rain. I had to say that because Monty's listening tonight. But
I think he offered or wanted to be put out a plug to be in the next movie too.
Yeah, he would be a good one to be in there. Yep.
All right. Well, you sound like you have contact information for him. with regard to soil testing, we had a question with, should I use fertilizer or lime when converting row crop ground to perennial pastures if a soil test suggests that?
Yeah. And this is one thing where, you know, I really think our ag system today has really shortchanged the farmers and ranchers. What we're recommending, what we're doing with our clients, we go in first and we do what's called a total nutrient extraction. Okay, so we take a soil probe 12 inches deep. We test that for nutrients, okay? And I mentioned earlier, we tested 45 farms in the upper Midwest here. Every single farm had plenty of nutrients. For any, you know, for even in North Dakota, we had enough nutrients for 300 bushel corn crop plus. And I'll guarantee you in Wisconsin, wherever you're at, if we go do a total nutrient extraction, you will have enough nutrients, okay? The difference is they're not available. So it's not nutrients that are lacking. It's the biology to make those nutrients available, okay? So we need to change the way we see things. and think of, okay, what do I have to do as a producer to get the biology to cycle those nutrients? Now, am I going to recommend that if you are in a conventional system using synthetics and you do a total nutrient extraction, it shows you have plenty, do I recommend you don't use synthetics? No, you'll have a wreck. You'll have a disaster. You'll be mad at me and calling me, and then I really won't sleep. You know, it's because you don't have the biology. Soil is like a drug addict. You got to wean it off slowly. So what we do then, we use total nutrient extraction. We use a Haney soil test and done at the appropriate lab that has the appropriate equipment. And then we do a PLFA test, phospholipid fatty acid, to determine how much biology you do have and the species you have. Now, the question was, would you fertilize in lime going into a perennial system? Here's what I'm going to tell people. You should not at all think about taking cropland and converting it to perennials if you don't have soil health in order. If you don't have soil well aggregated, if you don't have the biology, if you don't have soils that have a decent fungal to bacterial ratio, you're going to get a poor producing stand of perennials. So we need to first address soil function before we seed perennials. So you do that by using cover crops, for preferably with animal impact, animals grazing. It's just like succession. I tell people, okay, if the highway department builds a road, what's the first thing that grows in the ditch? Well, it's your, many people call them weeds. It's your forbs. Then come annual grasses. Then come the perennials. Those forbs, annual legumes and annual grasses, are preparing the soil, getting the nutrient cycle, water cycle, the aggregation in order so that perennials can establish. We need to think of our farms in that way. And if we're going to convert cropland to pasture, we better get those cycles in order first. Otherwise, they're not going to be highly productive pastures.
A question from Facebook was, if you could recommend one educational resource for newcomers, what would it be?
Soil Health Academy, of course. GrassWorks, I could say also, right? Go on your website. Yeah, the thing of it is, you need to seek out those individuals who have the experience and knowledge in your context, in your environment, who's been there, who's done that, and then learn from them. That's the number one advice I would give.
And then I guess with kind of that previous note with cover crop, you know, the succession, there's a few questions talking about what kind of pasture mixes to plant. And we had a question, when establishing a new pasture, would you recommend planting a native prairie mix?
Yeah. And what I'm going to do there, you know, GrassWorks has a lot of experienced individuals who are capable in that environment. I certainly do not have the expertise living in North Dakota of what works in Wisconsin or wherever you're at. I would recommend seeking out those individuals. Now, what I would say is I would try to get as much diversity as you can afford into those mixes, because the more diversity, the more nutrients that biology is going to cycle, the better for the animal health and eventually human health.
And I have another question I missed. We have several hundred sheep and goats. Have you observed what summer annuals they prefer, sorghum Sudan versus pearl millet?
Yes, and we do run sheep. We tried goats, but we found out quickly that we just didn't have the browse for goats. You know, there's not many trees here in North Dakota, so we didn't have the browse for goats, so we no longer run goats. But they actually prefer shorter growing species. They tend to shy away from the sorghum Sudan. Even pearl millet is a bit high. They prefer some of the other lower growing millets, is what we've found when we're grazing sheep on cover crops.
Another question was, any tips for washouts, fields that were conventional but now no-tilled with cover crops, but the washouts get deeper while transitioning?
Yeah, and you know, it's not a perfect world. you're going to have to go in there and fill in those washouts with some soil, and then make sure in above that, whatever's higher in elevation, you know, that water's coming from somewhere to start those washouts. You better have something established there to keep that water in place. But it's not a perfect world. You need to do what you have to do to fill them in and then move forward from there.
I had another couple of questions with residual and moving. What is kind of your standard as far as residual management and when you move them? Is there ever a time to graze lower, leave more?
Oh, as far as recovery time?
Residual more than recovery.
How low to graze on a plant? Well, it's proven that once you take, you know, when you move from 50% leaf area removal on a plant to 60%, that's a huge difference in the impact on the roots and how long it'll take that plant to recover. The only time I'm not going to say only, but rarely do we recommend over 50% removal of leaf area. There are times if you're in areas where if you don't remove more, it's going to become very lignified, like areas in a more brittle environment. And if you have the capability that you will not return for a long period of time, then I would take more. The only other time I can think of is if you have a paddock that, say, has not had livestock on it for years, and you've got that buildup of material litter on the soil, you may want to take it down a bit further.
What about kind of residual and management going into a winter season? One had a question of how tall should I leave the alfalfa going into winter, but your pastures in general?
Yeah, I personally like to leave much more rather than less. And the reason being is it'll be that much quicker to start in the spring, and you will see a noticeable difference. The more you leave in the fall, the quicker that'll get off and started the next year. But again, it's about context, you know. That's going to vary a little bit for every operation.
There's a question. Are there some soils or areas that were farmed in the past conventionally that just shouldn't be or won't be suitable for grazing? Heavy soils, poor draining, very acidic.
I haven't seen them. At one time, this whole continent was grazing. Now, through our mismanagement, the lack of stewardship, you know, you look at where I'm at, North Dakota, go up into southern Canada, huge areas of salinity, major salinity issues, et cetera. But we can heal those over time. So I don't think there's any areas that we can't graze. Now, there's certainly areas that on certain times of the year, you get into heavy clay soils, you know, very wet times of the year in early spring, you're going to want to have the livestock off those areas because they will pug it up severely, you know, and that's just the way it is. They need to be, you know, you need to remove livestock from them at that time of the year. But I don't know of any areas that can't benefit from a grazing ruminant.
All right, I have another question. We are currently transitioning several conventional crop properties that are several miles from our primary grazing operation to hay ground for stored feed with intention of eventually pasturing them. Any suggestions for those hay fields and overcrop fields going into hay in regards to adding fertility?
Yeah, and the best thing you can do, you need to think of it as energy flow. How can we capture enough sunlight on those fields, put that carbon, that energy into the soil to fuel the production and establishment of those perennials? So what I recommend is, just as I said earlier, diverse cover crop mixes, preferably grazed. Now, if you don't have the capability to graze them, if you're going to hay them off, leave plenty of stubble and make sure you hay them early so it has plenty of time to regrow. Pay particular attention, as I said earlier, to your fungal to bacterial ratio. Perennials will establish much more successful if that fungal to bacterial ratio is moving closer to 1:1.
There's another question with a large mass of grass to leave dry for winter feed, push it into the ground with some sort of roller crimper or slash and try to get it mulched. Do you have any suggestions for adding carbon?
Yeah, and what I say is that's what livestock are for, high stock density, you know, in Wisconsin, northern plains here, snow will knock most of that down. I often think that part of the problem with most producers is they haven't been broke enough. They're kind of looking for ways to spend money. Now, keep the money in the checkbook. Your wife will be much happier.
Sounds good. Are these practices being taught in college ag programs, or is there a greater emphasis on big farms and monocultures?
Well, I think we all know the answer to that question, but in all honesty, there are many good colleges that are starting to focus on these regenerative practices. I'm not going to name colleges, but there's getting to be more of them that really are beginning to realize, hey, we need to have a program in regenerative ag. And our business, Understanding Ag, we are working on curriculum for high schools and colleges as we speak. And our goal is to get more of them moved down that path.
Well, we appreciate it. What has worked and what hasn't worked with fencing your sheep herd?
Well, those of you who have heard me speak know that I tell people our sheep are on a planned grazing system. Wherever they plan on going, that's where they are. You know, we have found that we need woven wire in the dry season. Realize where I'm at in North Dakota, we get the majority of our moisture in about an 8-week window. And then we don't get much moisture until, 10 months from when it stops. So it becomes very dry and brittle. Then it's difficult to keep sheep in. They're going to go looking. And so we've found we go to woven wire to keep our sheep in. Now, the finishing lambs, which were grass finishing, obviously we have them on the best quality forage. And those we're able to keep in with simply two strands of polywire. And they're content. But they've got plenty to eat. Why would they leave? So, yeah, I by no means am a expert in sheep. So it's probably best to find others who have large flocks and do it full time to answer that question.
And we do have a few of those within GrassWorks too.
Great.
So we can reach out and we'll.
That's who you need to ask. Yep.
One other comment was tile drainage continues to increase in popularity. Some soil health guru farmers even promote tile as a necessary component to jumpstarting a healthy soil ecosystem. Mm-hmm. What is your opinion on tile drainage?
Yeah, tile drainage is for those who have significant tax problems and they're looking for a write-off. Okay. I am of the belief that, and I've consulted on enough farms, that proper soil health, proper management, there's no need for tile drainage. There just isn't. Tile drainage comes from the lack of understanding of how ecosystems function and the fact that we have not increased water use intensity enough. We're not using enough high water use crops. Now, I will say this much. I honestly believe the good Lord did not intend all land to be farmed. And there are some places out there that just should not be farmed, but you know, that's up to the landowner, private property owner. And, you know, it's kind of like the Dutch over there, you know, they want to farm the sea. So they just keep pushing more soil into the sea and farming it. Well, okay, who am I to say? That's their decision. So, yeah.
Monty did have a advice on single wire 12 inches off the ground. And then another question was,
To keep sheep in. Yeah. Good luck with that, Monty. Maybe pigs, but I want to see that, Monty. Show me a video and show me for a whole day that they're in there, not just for 2 minutes.
Exactly. Is there a financial return to be had planting cash crops or harvest into a natural pastured system in some sort of rotation?
Okay. So pasture cropping, like my friend Colin Seiss in New South Wales, Australia, absolutely in the right environment. But here's the key with that, and I've been over to Colin's a number of times. You have to have your perennial pasture has to be either cool season dominant or warm season dominant, and then you seed the opposite into that. So say for instance, up here, you know, in the northern tier, we're obviously gonna have cool season dominant pastures. Well, what you would do is when temperature rises and those cool seasons start shutting down, then you could go in and seed a warm season species. The problem is we don't have long enough growing season. You know, we don't have enough frost-free days to make that work. The only way I've been able to do it successfully up here is to go into my cool season dominant perennial pastures and then in late fall after frost, seed a fall-seeded biennial. Cereal rye, winter triticale, kale, forage winter wheat, hairy vetch. And then that will tend to get ahead of it and have it in the spring get ahead of the perennials. I've had some success. I see more opportunity for those down in Oklahoma, Texas, et cetera, where they have warm season dominant paddocks, being able to go in there fall the year and seed the cool Australia.
Okay. And this question kind of got brought up before, but it's been repeated many times. As an educator, how do you approach a monoculture crop farm and the concepts of regenerative agriculture, especially if their rotation does not include perennials or livestock?
The conversation always comes about that I'm not going to force anything on them. They have to have expressed an interest. Otherwise, I'm just not going to spend a lot of my time with them, because if they don't have an interest in changing, want to change, you know, open to ideas, suggestions, open to learning, I'm just beating my head against the wall and, you know, I don't have any hair the way it is. So why do I want to continue to do that? So, it has to, the conversation though, if it is to be had, starts from a financial aspect, you know, because let's face it, with farming and ranching, you know, finances are going to drive 90%+ of the decisions.
Any advice for farming tight red clay soils? Does applying calcium products like lime help loosen the soil?
Right now, we're consulting on about 22 million acres across North America, and we have not on one single occasion recommended anybody apply lime, okay? Because do the math, try applying enough to make it worthwhile. You can't, you know, you'll be broke by the time that you get that done. What needs to be done is we have to go in there with diversity, strong on grasses. This is where a lot of, I think, education needs to be done. So often people hear about tight clay soils and they think, oh, we got to plant a daikon radish or something to break up that tight clay, that hard pan. Look at drill bits nowadays. You go buy drill bits, they all have that little pilot on the end of it. You got to drill a pilot hole first, plant grasses first, and those grasses will do a better job getting between those tightly bound clay particles, breaking that up. And what we found, and we have good data to show this, we have trials, scientific trials that show this, that we're able to change pH just through diverse cover crops, change it more than you can applying lime at an economical rate.
Okay. Someone wants to know if Dale Strickler will be in Kisegon too.
I don't know. That's up for the producer to decide.
Okay. Another question is, what is the best way to smooth out some old hay fields that are very rough without destroying the soil biology?
Yeah, and here's what I tell people. This is the one time you're going to hear Gabe Brown talk about a disc. But what you do is you take a disc, set it on a level surface, and lower it to within, so the blades are within 1 inch of the soil surface. Put cylinder stops in there. Then you go out into that hay field at a 45 degree angle and disc it. And then the second pass over, go in the direction you're going to farm it or hay it. And you'll be amazed how that'll smooth that field out. It does a really good job. You leave all the root structure intact, but you're just leveling off all those pocket gopher mounds, etc.
Great. Fencing question. Recommendations for controlling plant growth in electric fences without using chemicals? So I'm guessing along the fence lines.
Mm-hmm. And that's going to depend a little bit on which plants. But what we've found, if you get it cleared and then leave your fencer on, so for instance, on our ranch, obviously we don't have a lot of trees or brush here, but Alan Williams down in Alabama, they certainly do. If you run high enough jewel fencers, on our ranch, we run all 36 jewel fencers, and you leave them on the entire growing season, early in the spring till fall, those trees, brush, grasses just won't grow up through that electric current. So high enough jewel fencer, once you get it cleared, leave it on the entire season.
Right. Someone wants to know what's the easiest way to gauge whether you're giving proper rest period to pastures.
Mm-hmm. And a great question. And the answer to that is the desirable plants, those that you prefer to see, are they recovered to the point that they're starting to show their seed head formation? Okay, I'm not saying that they're mature and going to seed. But the desirable species that you want, are the majority of those in that reproductive phase? Are they starting to form seed heads? Now, every once in a while, you will want to allow them to set seed and go to seed before you graze in order so that seed can drop and you can stimulate new seedlings. But that's how we look and determine if it's ready.
And that would be the same kind of if you are pushing for those forbs and such, you'd be wanting to wait until.
Yep, same principle.
What about pastures that have a lot of thistle and burdock?
Yep, and so you need to ask yourself, why are the thistles and burdock there? Now, there's several different types of thistles. You know, Russian thistle is often an indicator of high salts, okay? Your must thistle is often an indicator we're lacking nutrients found deeper in the soil profile. Too many people are just obsessed, oh, we can't have any must thistle, we can't have Canada thistle. Our livestock eat Canada thistle like it's candy. It's just a non-issue. Now, do they eat must thistle? They'll eat the blossoms once it's flowering, but they're not going to eat the plant. But realize that must thistle has a tremendously deep taproot, and it's cycling deep nutrients. There's a really good book out there entitled Weeds and What They Tell Us. And I encourage people to read that book, because all of these forbs or weeds are strictly indicators of a lack of a certain nutrients, or they came about as a result of lack of proper management. So we need to look at them as indicators and then adjust our management accordingly.
How did you get your livestock to eat the thistles? Was it a training thing, or was it within the herd? They all just hurt.
Yeah. And don't get me wrong. There's nothing wrong. You know, excuse me. I know there's people out there advocating going through the process, training your animals to eat these weeds. Well, All you have to do is run high enough stock densities and the behavior of your livestock change. So once you ratchet up to even 250,000 pounds per acre, preferably 500,000 pounds per acre, their behavior is going to change and they're going to eat, because if they don't, their neighbor's going to get it. And you do that a time or two, and those livestock will be eating thistles. We literally have not found anything that our cows won't eat. You know, they will eat about anything. Obviously not railroad ties or fence posts, but I'm talking about plants.
How about winter watering tips for grazing stockpiles away from barns?
And what do deer or bison do during the winter?
Eat snow. Okay.
Our cows winter on snow, and they've got calves hanging on them. Now, do I recommend that you just take your cow herd and go let them do that? And obviously, I'm not talking dairy here, but we literally do that. In fact, snow is one of our unfair advantages. So on properties that we lease, if we do not have water on them, we will graze those properties during the winter when there's snow. And some really good work done in Canada, and this was dry cows without calves, beef cows. They ran cows and allowed them access to running water, and then cows that had to winter on snow, there was only 27 pounds difference in body weight to those cows come spring. You know, my wife will tell you that Gabe should winter on snow. You know, yeah, it's not that bad a deal. And they become acclimated. And even with calves hanging on them, they do just fine. Now, it's taken us some years to get our livestock transitioned to the right type and kind that'll do that. But I don't see anything wrong with that. Now, I do want to tell you, though, that we do, because of how open we are and lack of protection, we do allow our cow herd the ability to walk back to a farmstead for shelter, because that's the only place they're going to get out of the wind. And so the majority of our cow herd does not make the trip back for water. They will come back if a storm is approaching, and then they can drink there if they want.
And how far have you had your herd migrate for water?
Oh, a couple miles. Yeah, over 2 miles.
Question from Kevin. We have some good grazers in Wisconsin. We see an incredible shift to tractor calf farming as small dairies have gone out of business. How can we promote using livestock and grass instead of corn and soybean farming and feeding? This barrier seems to be time to finish, daily labor, packing plant size requirements, etc. How can we scale up the grass-fed marketplace?
Yeah. Oh, what a great question, Kevin. And, you know, if there's one thing I would love to get across to people, and I think a little bit, to some degree, it's been exposed with COVID, is the importance to have a more localized food system and the importance to buy your food local and to support local farmers, ranchers. And I really think we may be able to make some inroads due to COVID. And I'll just tell you this right now, our business Understanding Ag is working with several investment funds that it's kind of a slow money fund, and they want to invest in infrastructure for regenerative ag. And that's one of the things that we highlighted for them, is the importance of these processing facilities, you know, these whether it be beef slaughter facilities, whether it be in dairy, you know, small cheese plants, et cetera. And they are looking at that strongly. They're starting to work on a couple of mid-size kill facilities for grass-finished pastured proteins. And I'm hoping that catches on even more, and we're able to really get society behind the need to support these small farms and to get value-added products. I wish, you know, if I was Secretary of Ag, which will never happen, but if I was, that's what I'd concentrate. We have to revitalize our small farms, rural communities. And that's the way to do that.
You're here. Next question was, in his book, Growing a Revolution, David Montgomery highlighted your occasional judicious use of herbicides as a keystone of his ideal organic-ish farming system. What do you consider appropriate use of herbicides?
Mm-hmm. And that's due to context. That's everyone's individual context. And I tell people, okay, last year on my 5,000 acre farm, our total herbicide bill was $19.95. And the reason for that is there was some forbs growing my wife did not care for, and I would rather be married than stick to not using any herbicides. So you have to look at your context and what it is. Now, in saying that, if I may just for a minute expand on that, we've been working on the nutrient density of foods issue, and we've been doing a lot of testing. We've been hired, well, I will just say one of them was David Montgomery. David Montgomery hired our firm to go test nutrient density on regenerative farms, then on neighboring farms growing, and we grew the same grain on, you know, and I was one of the farms, we grew it on my farm, we grew the same variety of grain on a neighboring conventional type farm. And we did this on many farms all across the United States. And Dr. Montgomery has a new book coming out. I think the name of it is going to be You Are What Your Food Eats. And what he's trying to highlight is, does organic matter? Yes, it's great for the lack of you know, herbicides, pesticides, etc. But how does the nutrient density compare? And it goes back to work that Dan Kittredge is doing with the Bionutrient Food Association. You know, we need a testing instrument that's able to test in real time that consumers can take into a grocery store, test product in real time, and then make their buying decisions based on that. And I will guarantee you the healthiest soil will always be higher in all these phytonutrients. We're working with Dr. Stephen Van Vliet at Duke University Medical Center. Dr. Van Vliet, by using a mass spectrometer, has the ability to measure 2,300 different phytonutrients, okay? We're seeking funding right now to actually do human trials comparing foods grown conventionally versus foods grown regeneratively. Once data like that gets out, that's going to drive this whole industry. It's going to drive farmers and ranchers. It's going to change the medical community. And we're really excited about it.
Is that going to be part of Kiss the Ground too, I hope, as well?
Maybe. We'll see.
Question was, do you slaughter animals year-round?
Okay, and that's another great question. And I will say some species. Now, on our ranch, we focus on direct to consumer, and it's frozen product primarily. And so we slaughter when that animal is getting what we believe is peak forage production. Now, COVID has thrown a little monkey wrench in that, the demand has far outstripped supply, and so we're having to slaughter some at not quite optimum time. But we try and harvest all of our animals when forages are at their peak.
Hey, thanks. We have some wooded pastures we graze that are being overrun with multi-floral rows. Any management recommendations to deal with such an invasive species?
Yeah, and that comes, you've got to get livestock in there. And if you have beef or dairy animals, that means I've seen people where they just edge a bale further and further into those woods and open it up, you know, with animals going in there and tromping, et cetera. Obviously, species such as goats, et cetera, can make an impact if you want to do that. I know of several people who are making a decent living now in that they are actually their custom grazing goats in areas that need it, you know, and people are paying them to bring the goats in, and then they also get to harvest the goats. And so it's a pretty lucrative business if you're smarter than a goat.
And they have some catchy names too, I know.
Yeah.
Another question was, if you're taking over rent on a farm that has been in conventional corn soy for 25 years and the soil is dead, you want to turn it into perennial pasture, but you can't put animals on it for a few years. You're going to hay it, but you want to seed it with native warm seasons.
Mm-hmm. And you have to do proper soil testing. You have to do a PLFA test, determine where your fungal to bacterial ratios are. And I would plant diverse cover crops in there, even if you're going to hay them. But realize the way to move the fungal component is you have to have some lignified type material. So you have to, for example, let's just use sorghum sedan, go in there, hay it early, you know, get a decent hay crop so you generate some dollars, but then let that regrow and let it get fairly far along. And in fact, if you're in a northern environment, use winter to your advantage, let it winter kill, and then the snow will lay it down and lay down that biomass, because that saprophytic fungi is blowing in the air all the time, and that will start decomposing it, and you'll start moving that fungal to bacterial ratio. But prepare the soil first. Get the nutrient cycle, mineral cycle working, the water cycle, the aggregation, before you seed it to perennials.
All right, next question was, do you think it's feasible in the northern tier, they're in the UP, to run finished steers with a main cow-calf pair herd? Do you think it's possible to combine the two herds and still meet the different goals for the animals through grazing practices? How to meet different production management goals between the different sets of animals?
Yes, to an extent, but it all gets back to context. One of the unfair advantages of a ruminant is that they're able to take highly lignified material and convert it, through the rumen. And if it depends on your context of what you have available to you. I mentioned that on our ranch, you know, we get the majority of our moisture in a 6 to 8 week window. That leaves a lot of highly lignified material. It would not be wisest, best use of my property, my land, if I eliminated the cow herd and just went all to grass finished. So, because grass finished animals are not gonna do well on that highly lignified material. So can that producer do it, run both groups together? Yes, but it's gonna be a give and take, you know. She is going to have to make sure that there is diversity there and that the forage quality is such that you can truly grass finish an animal. And that's one of the real challenges we're seeing right now with COVID, you know, tremendous demand for pastured proteins. Unfortunately, a lot of people, you know, they're selling grass fed animals as steaks, et cetera, where maybe you shouldn't be, you know, maybe you should be selling burger out of that animal instead. So you gotta put it in your context.
Have you worked with like a leader follower system, or do you think that would be appropriate for that producer?
And that would be, it would be a better option, you know, again, depending on context, does he have the forage? We have several clients that do use that. It can be used successful. The key to it, though, is you got to keep moving. Remember, these plants are going to start regrowing in about 3 days. So if you have a leader-follower system and you have your grass finishers biting off the choicest plants, but you're not coming with the follower for about 7 days, for example, well, that plant's going to give an adequate moisture. It's going to be regrowing. Well, those cows, those followers are going to go right after that same plant. Pretty soon you'll be losing diversity and you'll have more of the quote unquote less desirable plants show up.
Sure. One comment or question was, this year we transitioned a corn soy field over to the GrassWorks grazing mix. We did not graze or hay it this year and hope that it helped establish. We also did not apply any of the recommended amendments. After hearing you say we should have done annuals first, do you have any suggestions for boosting the biology? We aim to graze this coming spring.
The best way to boost that biology is by grazing. Realize that the biology in a rumen is very closely related to the biology in the soil. In fact, Alejandro Carrillo down in the Chihuahuan Desert, how he got grasses to establish in that desert was by the cows eating mature grasses, and then manure is, and the rumen is more fungal dominant. So he actually has photos of a cow pie and the grass seeds germinating in that cow pie. He used the cow pie to change the fungal component. So I would say the best thing for that particular person would be to graze that.
All right, and then I think I've got two more questions and then we're kind of coming up on the close. Like I said, Gabe did offer to stick around for any other follow-up questions, but we'll kind of be winding down. The next comment question was, my favorite chapter of your book was the one about your farm succession plan. What advice do you have for families trying to navigate the fair versus equal issue of farm assets?
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I like talking, well, I don't really enjoy talking about that, but I've seen it over and over and over again where one child stays and works the farm with the parents, the other ones go off, and then the parents don't have a good succession plan, and when they pass away, all of a sudden the other siblings think they're entitled. That's not fair to the child who has spent his or her adult life working on that farm. And my wife and I lived through that with her parents. And so we more or less had to buy the whole farm, but only own a third of it, you know? And we knew that we were not gonna put our son or our daughter through that. Whichever one wanted to stay on the farm and put the work in, they deserve it. And what you have to do is have an open, honest, frank conversation with your children or with your parents and say, hey, look, this is the way it is. You know, this is the way we see it, and then talk things out. So what we did before our son was even out of college, we sat down with him and his sister, and we knew that our son was going to come back to the farm, and we talked things out. And our daughter understood. She chose to have a career off the farm. That was her choice. But our son has helped build this ranch into what it is. He deserves more. Now, that doesn't mean we ignore her and she doesn't get nothing. No, she gets something, but she certainly does not get any of the land, because the land is integral to my son, our son, making a living. And so it's a matter of a frank, open, honest conversation.
All right, thank you. Off topic, back to other topics. All right, do you ever use a Bricks test on your forage? If so, what would be a good target?
Yeah, we use refractometers, Bricks meters all the time. And Dr. Alan Williams has done extensive work with refractometers, and the average Bricks reading across the United States is about a 3, okay, which is pretty low. For every 1 point you raise Bricks, you can get about a 10th of a pound increase in average daily gain in a beef animal. Now, obviously, there's differences in genetics. We're talking in generalities. This can also be related to milk components, milk solids. As you increase Bricks, you're going to increase those components in milk. So what we have found, so in other words, if you have a 3 Bricks, and livestock are eating it, at a 3 Bricks, you're going to gain between 0.5 and 1 pound a day. You move, though, to a 13 Bricks, you'll probably be gaining closer to 2 pounds a day. What we've found is during the finishing phase for our livestock, we like them to be on forages greater than 20 Bricks. And if we're on greater than 20 Bricks, we're going to be putting on 3.5 to 4 pounds a day on those finishing animals. And so always take your Bricks readings in the afternoon. Always take them on the area of the plant, the leaf area that the animals are consuming. And this comes down to observation. You need to observe what those animals are eating and then test the bricks on that accordingly. It's a good handy tool, and it really helps to hone your observation skills also. And I will also say, if you're putting up any type of hay, haylages, silages, you need to be using a refractometer, and you certainly should not be cutting any hay or silage in the morning. Bricks readings will always be higher in the afternoon due to photosynthesis. So why would anyone consider cutting hay in the morning? They're leaving the nutrients in the soil, and they're not going to have it in the plant. Now, there's nothing wrong with leaving some nutrients in the soil, but you're going through the work and expense of putting up forage. Make sure it's the highest bricks you can possibly have.
Do you change your management times also by moving during that high bricks period, or not quite so much?
Absolutely. And we've seen this over and over again. One of the ways we make money for our clients is simply by telling them if they're running a stocker program, grass finish program, dairy herd, whatever the case may be, you're going to want to do your moves in the afternoon. Now, if you're doing multiple moves per day, don't do your first move until late morning and then do multiple moves in the afternoon. Or if you're moving once a day, make sure that move is in the afternoon when it's highest bricks, and you will increase average daily gains. We've seen over and over in stocker programs an increase of about 0.25 pound average daily gain per head per day by moving in the afternoon versus moving in the morning. That's significant when you start talking several hundred head.
And how do you increase the bricks readings? It's the sugar in the plant just by improved soil health?
That's exactly right. It all gets back to soil health. And this is one of the things we see in people moving down the regenerative path. They may not be able to see it immediately with the naked eye, but it's things such as a refractometer measuring bricks that you can show them. See, this is different, and you're moving in the right direction. Now realize it'll vary year to year according to moisture conditions, plant growth, etc. It's going to vary. It's always not going to be in the peak. You can come on my ranch at times and find stuff with, plants with 3 to 5 bricks. It's not all a Garden of Eden here by any means, but you need to use that as a tool and work with it.
Sure. And then I have another question. Since I straddle the world of ag and healthcare and find myself in conversations with people who have pretty negative views of agriculture because of climate change and desertification, do you partner with any health related organizations or groups? Seems like a great way to educate more broadly.
Oh, I love that question. If you know my three partners, Dr. Alan Williams, Ray Archuleta, and Shane New, and myself, we are all focused on the belief that soil health, human health is directly related to soil health. And one of the reasons we have such a health crisis is because of the lack of health of our soil ecosystems. We are, as a matter of fact, tomorrow I have a Zoom meeting with a group of doctors, and we are almost in daily conversation with the medical community, educating them and then learning together with them. I mentioned, Dr. Stephen Van Vliet at Duke, and we're working with Dr. Mark Hyman and Dr. Zach Bush and many, many others from the medical community. And they're educating us, we're educating them, but all of us are just focused on educating consumers as to the importance of nutrient density and soil health. And that kind of, if I may, Rachel, that brings up another question. People often say, well, but people can't afford to purchase regenerative products because they're higher priced. Well, what's your health worth? And I use this as an example. My son and I were at the farmer's market with our concession trailer a number of years ago, and a gentleman walked up to the trailer, and there was a line there, and he gets up to the counter and he looks at the prices and he says, boy, your meat is pretty expensive. Before we could say anything, the person behind him says, I just had to pay for a triple bypass. This meat is cheap. Okay. So it's thinking of food as medicine. We have to realize that it's preventative medicine. Eating healthy, eating nutrient-dense food will lower healthcare costs for everyone involved. We need to think of it that way. And we as farmers and ranchers cannot be afraid to charge for that. And we should not be afraid and ashamed to charge for that. One of the things we do when we're marketing, like at farmers markets, et cetera, is we have a box of cereal right there below the counter. And if somebody comes up and starts to lecture us about the cost, we just ask them, do you eat cereal? And then when they, you know, the vast majority do, we just pull out that box of cereal and say, okay, what are you paying per ounce for that cereal in that box? Now let's explain and look at the nutrient difference in the same ounces for the same price that you can get by buying our product. Always the pastured protein is going to be by far the better buy. So we just have to change how we approach the consumer, and then let's work with the medical community instead of against them.
Yep. Pay your farmer, not your pharmacist.
That's right.
All right. Another question. The biggest questions in the livestock world about methane emissions, pollutions from manure, and habitat destruction. Mm-hmm. What's your summary of how livestock actually enhance the ecosystem?
Oh, you're going to love it when we finish. There's a very big project going on right now. Dr. Williams is involved with, Peter Bick is involved with it. And actually, there's many corporations that are funding this, where we are getting the data that shows beyond a shadow of a doubt, it's the scientific data, it will hold up to peer review, that shows that grazing animals are significantly sequestering more carbon than the conventional production model. And once that data gets out and is replicated, will be replicated on the Northern Plains this year. There's a big project that will start this year on the Northern Plains. And there's no doubt we're going to be able to replicate it up here. That is going to really open people's eyes to the power of grazing animals and just how much of that carbon and those gases we can take out of the atmosphere and put in the soil. The thing about methane, you know, never in any of those articles that are anti-grazing animals because of methane, there's not a one of them that talks about methanotrophs. Methanotrophs are free living bacteria that consume methane as livestock expel it while they're grazing. That's never taken into account. And that's a huge player. If we had a methane problem, ask me this then. Historically speaking, it's believed that there were many, many more bison grazing the plains and grazing North America than there are beef and dairy animals on the continent today. Okay, why didn't we have this problem back then? You know, see, but they just don't think of that, you know.
Right.
Lost too many brain cells somewhere, evidently.
Well, it'll be nice to have those studies out, because I know I did read in some of the critique of the film, or in just regenerative agriculture in general, that there isn't science behind this.
And we're getting there. But there's a reason for that, Rachel. Who's going to pay for that science? Okay, is Bayer, Monsanto, the chemical industries, is the implement dealership going to pay for that? No. You know, science done at land-grant university is always paid for by some type of business. Okay, who's going to pay for that in regenerative ag? Nobody. So fortunately, there are businesses and organizations, foundations that are stepping up and paying for it now. We're getting there, just not fast enough, maybe.
Well, take some bit. So we got a couple other questions about, we have access to lots of composted wood chips. If our soils are low in fungal counts, would you suggest spreading this on a newly planted pasture? Along with that was compost teas added to boost soil biology when it is not present.
Mm-hmm. And excellent question. Yes, adding wood chips would increase the fungal component, but you have to be very careful because carbon and nitrogen are tied together. For every one part you have of nitrogen in the soil, you need 11 parts of carbon. Well, if you're adding a lot of wood chips are very, very high carbon, you know, 100 to 1 or even more, up to 300 to 1 in some cases. Okay, now you're going to need some nitrogen. Otherwise, you're not going to have any production. So be very careful if you go out and spread a lot of wood chips and then you're going to be calling Gabe, hey, I got no forage production. Well, yeah, you didn't add any nitrogen to balance that out. So you got to be very, very careful in that regard. What was the second part
of the question? The compost teas.
Oh, yes, compost teas. So, yes, compost teas are biology, okay? I have seen compost teas work well as an amendment to jumpstart or to boost or, for instance, in vegetable gardens, orchards. Are they practical, large-scale in production ag? We've done a lot of work by we, I mean the Burley County Soil Conservation District here in North Dakota, did a lot of work with compost teas, and what we found, large-scale production agriculture, pretty marginal return. That does not mean they shouldn't be used and can't be used. It's just don't look at them as a replacement for following the six principles.
Okay, a question about cafeteria-style mineral feeding programs.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And yes, animals certainly have the ability to select for nutrients. And I will say this, as you start moving down this path, especially if you're moving from a conventional system, it is good to offer those minerals to an animal. We did when we started out. However, as soil health advanced, our animals ate less and less mineral and salt. And now we haven't fed mineral or salt. I think we're going on 6 years now. We haven't had to feed any to any of our livestock. The only thing we purchase is oyster shells for the laying hens. That's the only supplement any of our livestock get. And but your livestock are going to tell you that through observation. I encourage you to put out a good quality mineral as you start out and salt and then observe your livestock. It got to the point where our 800, we usually run between 800 and 1,000 head of beef animals on our ranch. We were down the last year we fed 38 bags of mineral. Well, that's nothing on a herd that size. And so I knew at that time, all we were doing was propping up the bottom end. No, just get rid of the bottom end, then you don't have that problem.
Yep. I guess another way you're saving money with soil
That's
health.
Right.
Here's another question. When trying to practice regenerative no dig in Wisconsin with gardening, is there any tips for improving diversity of soil health? We are moving to use fall cover crops and apply heavy cow and chicken compost in the spring.
Okay. In our northern environments, and gardening is actually one of Gabe's favorite topics because I just think you can show people so much in a garden. And besides, there's, you know, look at what they call tomatoes. You know, go to a restaurant and get a tomato on a burger or something. Is that really a tomato? You know, nothing like out of the garden. So in our shorter environment, it's very difficult to grow enough fall season covers to cycle enough energy to fuel the system. A better option would probably be to split your garden in half, plant full season cover crops on one half of it, garden on the other half, and then the next year switch. Just keep rotating. What I do instead of that is in the fall of the year, after we harvest everything, I take some second cutting alfalfa hay, and I need to buy that hay because I'm not producing monocultures, but I roll that over the entire garden. We cover the entire garden in a blanket of alfalfa hay. Then in the spring of the year, all I do is part that hay and either put my transplants in there or plant the seed. And then during the growing season, the earthworms, et cetera, biology will consume that hay. So I'll add a little bit of wood chips on top just in those spots. So think of what I'm doing. I got alfalfa hay, high in nitrogen, wood chips, high in carbon. I'm balancing that carbon-nitrogen ratio, using that as both the weed barrier and as the fuel to feed biology.
All right, maybe we'll take one more question, and then to be respectful of your time and so you're fully energized for your meeting tomorrow. We've got, is it worthwhile to spread composted manure onto paddocks with poor soil after grazing season?
Oh, and this gets back also to the gardening question. I didn't finish that gardening question where they mentioned putting chicken litter and manure on the garden. Same type of thing. There is no better form of fertility than what falls out of the back end of an animal, no matter what that species is. It's full of biology. Now, notice I said falls out of them. There is a significant difference between fresh manure that comes out of an animal and that has come out of, is stored manure. So either it was a manure that's been composted or out of a slurry, etc. We are actually finding, as we work with our clients who have a lot of stored manure, that can be extremely detrimental to soil health. Carbon-nitrogen ratios, you add too much of that nitrogen, even though a lot of stored manure is lower in nitrogen, it's still more than the system can handle. So then what happens, the biology feeds on that nitrogen, it goes looking for those 11 parts carbon. Pretty soon, there goes your aggregation, there goes your water infiltration rates. You're having negative ramifications on soil health. So I would say this, you can apply some, but do so sparingly.
All right, any other questions? I was gonna do a follow-up comment where the nitrogen with legumes and pastures with similar issues with losing soil structure and carbon.
We see that over and over again, too much legumes. The other thing I will mention is we're seeing this reoccurring problem. People have pink eye and particular problems. 95%+ of the time, if you have pink eye problems, you go back 30, 60 days, what were you feeding those animals? I'll almost guarantee you they were getting too much protein. Pink eye is just a symptom of the feeding of excess protein. So there was too much legumes in the pastures or what you were feeding them.
All right. Any other questions, comments? Thank you so much. I'm going to hand it over to Heather. She's going to kind of go through our final credits, thank yous, and then some upcoming GrassWorks events. Thank you very much, Gabe.
Thank you. Enjoyed it. Good luck, everyone.
Not sure if Heather is back on, but we'll probably do a follow-up email, at least with some of the upcoming GrassWorks events.
So I am on. Sorry, everyone. I was trying to share my screen again. But I wanted to, again, thank all the sponsors for tonight, the Fay Gale Conservation Foundation, Prairie Creek Seed, Cash and Farm Supply, and Egg Country Farm Credit. And then I did want you all to know that we have some events coming up January 14th. We're going to be doing a grazing business tips with Paul Dittman and Mary L. Hewitt. And on January 21st is our annual membership meeting, and we're going to bring in an amazing speaker. So make sure you become members so that you can come to that meeting. And then February 11th, there is low stress animal handling with Kurt Pate. It's going to be interesting. I'm trying to do low stress animal handling via Zoom, but I know he's taking a lot of video footage and we're going to be playing all that. So it should be a good evening as well. And then if you haven't heard, GrassWorks is joining forces with four other organizations to put on a larger virtual conference called Growing Stronger collaborative conference on organic and sustainable farming. That'll be February 22nd through the 27th. If you want to learn more about that, you'll have to go to the GrassWorks website, to the Grazing conference page, and look for the link to that. Rachel, you have anything else?
I just included the links to the GrassWorks website and then the GrassWorks membership form. I always have to try to encourage everyone to join the GrassWorks Ask a Grazer forums, both on Facebook as well as there's an email listserv. The more people we have on, the better we all can, more we can all benefit from each other.